Train that look. I just saw your text come through right as I was hitting the live button. I was like, she'll get the notification. Nope, tomorrow is the day of rest. Shabbat Shalom, Dana. And Devon, if he did in the background. Singing in the background. Hold on, where my book? Oh, it's covered up. Hi, beautiful people. Happy Saturday. Happy Saturday. It is December the 11th, 2021, day 325 of year 3 of reading through the books of the Law and the Prophets. Another 3-year consecutive day count, day 993. Y'all, we're reading Proverbs 22, 23, and 24 today. And then we're going to pick up where we left off and Jesus Never Existed on page 55. Let's go ahead and do the Shema, which is found in Deuteronomy chapter 6. Slide this down. Hopefully we're good today with the Wi-Fi. I went and unplugged the extender. I think it's weird. I think the extender was interfering because it kept... The connections kept jumping back and forth from the regular Wi-Fi to the extender. And I think that's what was causing the issue yesterday. So I hope I solved the problem. We'll see. If it start acting up, we'll have to deal with it when it comes. But I gotta test one thing after the next just to make sure. But I'm hoping that was it. So if that was it, we good. We shouldn't have the technical difficulties we had yesterday. Okay, so Deuteronomy chapter 6 NLT. And I'm using the New Living Translation, beautiful people. But still, the New Living Translation still has God and Lord and stuff. So I think people keep asking me, they probably don't hear me when I tell them. When I read, it doesn't matter which version I'm reading, but if it's a version where it doesn't have the name of Yah, I will replace the general terms and I'll put Yah's name back in there, right? So I think people be looking for the version that I'm reading with that in there, but there are versions where they actually have taken out all the general terms and put his name back in there. Those are easy to find. You got like the, I think one of them is the Hallelujah Scriptures. One is the Sefer. There is another one. Got the Not Serene version of the Bible. I got that one. It's quite a few other ones. They're out there, you know. So, all right, beautiful people. Josiah. Shalom, bro. All right, y'all. A call for wholehearted commitment. These are the commands, decrees, and regulations that Yahuwah, your God, commanded me to teach you. You must obey them in the land you are about to enter and occupy. And you and your children and grandchildren must fear Yahuwah your God as long as you live. If you obey all his decrees and commands, you will enjoy a long life. Listen closely. I'm Choppy and Skippy already. Yeah, I remember you quit, Trina. Is your connection choppy, Trina? Choppy, Skippy. Okay, I'm going to keep going. Answer it, and I'm going to keep reading up the call for wholehearted commitment. Shayla, hey girl, hey. Listen closely, Israel, and be careful to obey. Then all will go well with you, and you will have many children in the land flowing with milk and honey, just as Yahuwah, the God of your ancestors, promised you. I'm going to do something in a second. Hold on, let me finish reading this. Listen, O Israel, Yahuwah, our God, he is God alone. And you must love Yahuwah your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your strength. And you must commit yourself wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road, when you're going to bed and when you're getting up. Tie them to your hands and wear them on your forehead as reminders. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Yahuwah your God will soon bring you into the land that he swore to give to you when he made a vow to your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It is a land with large, prosperous cities that you did not build. The houses will be richly stocked with goods you did not produce. You will draw water from cisterns you did not dig, and you will eat from vineyards and olive trees you did not plant. When you have eaten your fill in this land, be careful not to forget Yahuwah who rescued you from slavery in the land of Egypt. You must fear Yahuwah your God and serve him. When you take an oath, you must only use his name. You must not worship any of the gods of the neighboring nations, for Yahuwah your God who lives among you is a jealous God. His anger will flare up against you and he will wipe you from the face of the earth. You must not test Yahuwah your God as you did when you complained at Massa. Yes, I'm talking. Close it out and open it back up. Close it and open it back. Close Facebook, then open Facebook back up. Y'all, I don't know. In the future, your children, I'm sorry. Let me go back up. I'm sorry, y'all. You must not worship any of the gods of the neighboring nations, for Yahuwah your God who lives among you is a jealous God. His anger will flare up against you, and he will wipe you from the face of the earth. You must not test Yahuwah your God as you did when you complained at Massa. You must diligently obey the commands of Yahuwah your God and all the laws and decrees he has given you. Do what is right and good in Yahuwah's sight, so all will go well with you. Then you will enter and occupy the good land that Yahuwah swore to give your ancestors. You will drive out all the enemies living in the land, just as Yahuwah said you would. In the future, your children will ask you, what is the meaning of these laws, decrees, and regulations that Yahuwah our God has commanded us to obey? Then you must tell them, we were Pharaoh's slaves in Egypt, but Yahuwah brought us out of Egypt with his strong hand. Yahuwah did miraculous signs and wonders before our eyes, dealing terrifying blows against Egypt and Pharaoh and all his people. He brought us out of Egypt so he could give us this land he had sworn to give to our ancestors. And Yahuwah, our God, commanded us to obey all these decrees and to fear him so he can continue to bless us and preserve our lives as he has done to this day. For we will be counted as righteous when we obey all the commands Yahuwah, our God, has given us. Is it better over here, Trina, on YouTube? I might have to post a link for YouTube over Facebook today. If it's still chopped, I'm gonna call Verizon back out here and have them run a test on this. Cause I followed the directions on everything. Everything was really like plug and play, y'all. But everything else, like, I'm not having any issues. It's good over here. Okay. All right, Facebook. If it's still choppy over here, jump over to YouTube. Let me share the link. I'm gonna have to see. Okay. Here's the live streaming link for YouTube. If it's choppy, hop over to YouTube. Okay. Okay, y'all. Proverbs chapter 22. Oh, Trina, it's Saturday. You off today? Give me a call when we get done or text me. I want to hear about what happened to you when you, what you was telling me about when you was praying in tongues. Looks good now. Sounds great. Okay, Christy. Okay, Christy said Facebook is good now. Okay. Okay, Proverbs chapter 22. Choose a good reputation over great riches. Being held in high esteem is better than silver or gold. The rich and poor have this in common. Yahuwah made them both. A prudent person foresees danger and takes precautions. The simpleton goes blindly on and suffers the consequences. True humility and fear of Yahuwah lead to riches, honor, and long life. Corrupt people walk a thorny, treacherous road, Whoever values life will avoid it. Direct your children onto the right path, and when they are older, they will not leave it. Just as the rich rule the poor, so the borrower is servant to the lender. Those who plant injustice will harvest disaster, and their reign of terror will come to an end. Blessed are those who are generous, because they feed the poor. Throw out the mocker, and the fighting goes too. Quarrels and insults will disappear. Whoever loves a pure heart and gracious speech will have the king as a friend. Yahuwah preserves those with knowledge, but he ruins the plans of the treacherous. A lazy person claims, "There's a lion out there. If I go outside, I might be killed." The mouth of an immoral woman is a dangerous trap. Those who make Yahuwah angry will fall into it. A youngster's heart is filled with foolishness, but physical discipline will drive it far away. A person who gets ahead by oppressing the poor or by showering gifts on the rich will end in poverty. Listen to the words of the wise. Apply your heart to my instruction, for it is good to keep these sayings in your heart and always ready on your lips. I am teaching you today. Yes, you. So you will trust in Yahuwah. I have written 30 sayings for you, filled with advice and knowledge. In this way, you may know the truth and take an accurate report to those who sent you. Don't rob the poor just because you can, or exploit the needy in court. For Yahuwah is their defender. He will ruin anyone who ruins them. Don't befriend angry people. Or associate with hot-tempered people, or you will learn to be like them and endanger your soul. Don't agree to guarantee another person's debt or put up security for someone else. If you can't pay it, even your bed will be snatched from under you. Don't cheat your neighbor by moving the ancient boundary markers set up by previous generations. Do you see any truly competent workers? They will serve kings rather than working for ordinary people. Next chapter, Proverbs 23. Yahuwah is one. Yes. May the great spirit of Yahuwah bless and guide you too. Hallelujah. Proverbs 23. While dining with the ruler, pay attention what is put before you. If you are a big eater, put a knife to your throat. Don't desire all the delicacies, for he might be trying to trick you. Don't wear yourself out trying to get rich. Be wise enough to know when to quit. In the blink of an eye, wealth disappears, for it will sprout wings and fly away like an eagle. Don't eat with people who are stingy. Don't desire their delicacies. They are always thinking about how much it costs. Eat and drink, they say, but they don't mean it. You will throw up what little you've eaten, and your compliments will be wasted. Don't waste your breath on fools, for they despise the wisest advice. Don't cheat your neighbor by moving the ancient boundary markers. Don't take the land of defenseless orphans, for their Redeemer is strong. He himself will bring their charges against you. Commit yourself to instruction and listen carefully to words of knowledge. Don't fail to discipline your children. The rod of punishment won't kill them. Physical discipline may well save them from death. My child, if your heart is wise, my own heart will rejoice. Even in me, everything in me will celebrate when you speak what is right. Don't envy sinners, but always continue to fear Yahuwah. You will always be rewarded for this. Your hope will not be disappointed. My child, listen and be wise. Keep your heart on the right course. Do not carouse with drunkards or feast with gluttons, for they are on their way to poverty, and too much sleep clothes them in rags. Listen to your father who gave you life, and don't despise your mother when she is old. Get the truth and never sell it. Also, get wisdom, discipline, and good judgment. The father of godly children has a cause for joy. What a pleasure to have children who are wise. So give your father and mother joy. May she who gave you birth be happy. Oh, my son, give me your heart. May your eyes take delight in following my ways. A prostitute is a dangerous trap. A promiscuous woman is as dangerous as falling into a narrow well. She hides and waits like a robber, eager to make more men unfaithful. Oh, I got a good story for that with my son the other day. Oh, I'm going to share it with y'all. Hold on. Who has ain't? Hold on, let me remember this verse. Who has anguish? Who has sorrow? Who is always fighting? Who is always complaining? Who has unnecessary bruises? Who has bloodshot eyes? It is one who spends long hours in the taverns, trying out new drinks. Don't gaze at the wine, seeing how red it is, how it sparkles in the cup, how smoothly it goes down. For in the end, it bites like a poisonous snake. It stings like a viper. You will see hallucinations and you will say crazy things. You will stagger like a sailor tossed at sea, clinging to a swaying mast. And you will say, they hit me, but I didn't feel it. I didn't even know it when they beat me up. When will I wake up so I can look for another drink? Last chapter for the day, Proverbs chapter 4. Then I'll come back and tell you a little quick story. Don't envy evil people or desire their company, for their hearts plot violence and their words always stir up trouble. A house is built by wisdom and becomes strong enough through good sense. Through knowledge, its rooms are filled with all sorts of precious riches and valuables. The wise are mightier than the strong. Those with knowledge grow stronger and stronger. So don't go to war without wise guidance. Victory depends on having many advisors. Wisdom is too lofty for fools. Among leaders at the city gate, they have nothing to say. A person who plans evil will get a reputation as a troublemaker. The schemes of a fool are sinful. Everyone detests a mocker. If you fail under pressure, your strength is too small. Rescue those who are unjustly sentenced to life. Save them as they stagger to their death. Don't excuse yourself by saying, look, we didn't know. For Yahuwah understands all hearts and he sees you. He guards your soul. He who guards your soul knows you knew. He will repay all people as their actions deserve. My child, eat honey, for it is good. And the honeycomb is sweet to the taste. In the same way, wisdom is sweet to your soul. If you find it, you will have a bright future and your hopes will not be cut short. Don't rush and ambush at the home of the godly. Don't raid the house where the godly live. The godly may trip 7 times, but they will get up again. But one disaster is enough to overthrow the wicked. Don't rejoice when your enemies fall. Don't be happy when they stumble. For Yahuwah will be displeased with you and turn his anger away from them. Don't fret because of evildoers. Don't envy the wicked, for evil people have no future. The light of the wicked will be snuffed out. My child, fear Yahuwah and the king. Don't associate with rebels, for disaster will hit them suddenly. Who knows what punishment will come from Yahuwah and the king? Here are some further sayings of the wise. It is wrong to show favoritism when passing judgment. A judge who says to the wicked, you are innocent, will be cursed by many people and denounced by the nations. But it will go well for those who convict the guilty. Rich blessings will be showered on them. An honest answer is like a kiss of friendship. Do your planning and prepare your fields before building your house. Don't testify against your neighbors without a cause. Don't lie about them. Don't say, now I can pay them back for what they've done to me. I'll get even with them. I walk by the field of a lazy person, the vineyard of one with no common sense. I saw that it was overgrown with nettles. It was covered with weeds, and its walls were broken down. Then, as I looked and thought about it, I learned this lesson. A little extra sleep, a little more slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and then poverty will pounce on you like a bandit, and scarcity will attack you like an armed robber. And that, my beautiful people, is our reading for today. Marie, shalom, shalom. Okay, y'all, let me tell y'all this little quick story real quick about my son and his growing pains and him learning to put wisdom into play. And at a point when he don't know what to do, he'll come and ask the advice of me or of his father, right? So this particular time, dealing with a girl, this is about a week ago now. It's about a week ago. So this one girl who said, he said that they were just friends, right? He said kind of like his best friend. But I'm like, yeah, okay. You know, so I kind of realized that it wasn't really just like friends. It was a little more than friends. They was doing a little more than just how friends talk, right? So he comes to me last week. And he was like, Ma, he said, I got to ask you something. I said, okay, what? He said, hold on, how did he start it off? He said, he didn't ask a question. He said, I got a question. He said, well, maybe not a question. Let me just tell you what happened, right? And so he said, okay. So me and, I ain't going to say his friend name, but his female friend, right? His female friend. He said they had been talking for a while. So I'm listening. I'm thinking it was somebody else and not who he had called his friend. Like they were like best friends. So while he's explaining this, I'm thinking he's talking about another girl, right? But then to get down to the end of the conversation, when he was saying, he said, it's like she's trying to pressure me to have sex with her, right? And so right there, the whole conversation, just like, you need to come talk to me about this? That was my first thought, but I'm glad he did, because he's thinking here, right? And not with his hormones, which I guess it kind of shocked me, because teenagers, not that my son is one of those teenagers, but I mean, he was just casually talking to me like he was just talking to me about like something I was going to cook for dinner tonight, right? He said, it seems like she's trying to pressure me to have sex with her. I'm like, seems like, or is she? He said, I think she is, but I think she's saying it, but she's not saying it in those words. She was kind of like using, what he said, it's like she's trying to, I forget the word he said, but it's almost like, she was trying to use like that Jedi mind trick on him to like trip him up. So what he was explaining, as he began to explain what was happening, I'm like, bruh, that sounds just like Proverbs chapter 5 and chapter 7. And those are like the prostitute chapters, right? Well, not prostitute chapters, but it's talking about how cunning and sly women and women who use their womanly wiles trip men up, and many unsuspecting men become her victims, and they make their bed in hell, right, or in the grave when they come across her path. So what he was explaining, I said, wait, how old is this girl? He said, she's 17. And Jeremiah just turned 18, right? Yeah, she's throwing out sly innuendos, Marie. Look, and I'm like, 17? I'm like, who is her teachers? Because what he was saying, I'm trying to be anonymous with this. And I'm not quite sure that she watches my videos in the morning, but if she does, she gonna know I'm talking about her. Girl, get it together. Get it together, young lady. Look, but also a couple of his other friends watch me as well. So I don't wanna give out names or give too much detail, but I'm trying to give you the gist of what was going on. They get the same kind of talks. Yeah, talk to them, Marie. Make sure, just like we talk to the girls, talk to the men the same way. Listen, baby, don't give your strength to women, right? Especially these young ones. They don't know what they're doing. Not that they should know what they're doing. They should know what they're doing. But you don't just give it to anybody, right? Save it. Let something be sacred and special. Save that for somebody you plan on actually building a life with, right? Look, so he was like, I was like, well, first of all, I said, is y'all I said, first of all, before I asked them the conversation, I said, well, is that y'all, I said, how is she even approaching with that type of conversation? I said, is that the type of conversations y'all have? You know, are y'all talking about sexual things all the time? He said, well, no, that's the thing. He said, okay. He said, I'm gonna be honest. He said, sometime the topic do come up, you know. He said, and I may say some things that I probably shouldn't say. He said, but I wasn't like going to pursue it for real. You know, he said, I was just trying to really kind of feel out where she was. I'm like, well, why were you just trying to kind of feel out where she was if you weren't going to try and pursue it? He said, I don't know. He said, Mom, it was dumb. He said, but now she keeps, he said, she keeps bringing it up. And I think he kind of, he not scared, but he's just like, listen, girl, look, you need to get your mind out the gutter. So I was like, well, let me read something to you. I said, do you remember what Proverbs chapter 5 and chapter 7 say? He said, no, not really, not right off the top of my head. So I pulled up the app and I read it to him. And he said, yo, he said everything, like word for word, that's what's happening. So what she said to him, and the reason why he came and talked to me was, and his dad wasn't here. His dad was out on job. He didn't go to work with him that day. But the reason why he even came and talked to me is because she was at the point now where she was trying to, like, she really wanted a piece of him, right? She said to him, and mind you, she has a boyfriend. So by this time, he told me, I said, well, who is this little girl? And he told me her name. I'm like, and I repeated her name. I said, wait a minute. The one that's just your friend? Like, I already knew that, right? I was like, y'all spend, granted, you can spend time with the opposite sex and it truly be a true friendship, right? But sometimes I catch the eyes going back and forth. I'm like, yeah, that's a little bit more. They little more than friends. But she has a boyfriend, right? And I knew that. I knew she had another boyfriend. So that's why I was like, yeah, okay. I said, Jeremiah, you need to be careful, right? Because who you spend time with is who you become intimate with. The more time, especially with the opposite sex, I said, the more time you spend with the opposite sex, it tends to get intimate when that's not even your intentions. I say, so you have to be careful. You have to guard your time. If she has a boyfriend, you want to be careful. And especially if you know him. He knew who her boyfriend was. They weren't like friends. They were just kind of like acquaintances. I'm like, you don't want to do that. I say, and you'll speak to him when you go out. He know you spending this much time with his woman on the phone. I said, that's a big no-no. I said, you really shouldn't be talking to her on the phone like that. I said, first of all, y'all like 17 and 18 years old. It's not like middle school sweethearts and stuff. These are like grown people about to get their life, right? And men don't play about their women. And women don't play about their men. I said, so don't put yourself in that situation. But what happened was she started saying, she said, well, she said, I know we're just friends. And this is what she told him. And like I said, this is why he came to talk to me, because he really felt some type of way. I'm like, she ain't really your friend. She's not really your friend from the beginning. She just there to try to look like we say to women, just try and get in your pants, right? She really just trying to get into your pants, because she told him, she said, in order for us to continue being friends, she said, I need to try it out. I need to know what my best friend working with. I'm like, shut your mouth. She said that to you. He said, yeah, Mom. He said, and I feel some type of way. She said, like, we can't be friends no more if I don't have sex with her. I said, don't have sex with that hoe. Like, I said like that, excuse me. I said, you need to call her off. I said, no. I said, no. Absolutely not. I said, absolutely not. Like, she's giving you an ultimatum. And she gonna, like she said, like, I was baffled. I didn't know what he was about to say. But that really took me for a loop. Like, she said, well, if you don't, we just gonna have to start separating. I was like, bro, it was that from the beginning. I like, her boyfriend knows she do stuff like that. Apparently, he don't know she do stuff like that. I'm like, that girl better watch it. She can get herself hurt down the road somewhere doing that. Yo, look, access denied. These are hussy treats. Marie, look. I'm like, yeah, she dated. She said that before to somebody else. That's what I'm like, who was her teachers? What women are around her? Where's her mama? Where's her mama? Right? Where her aunties? Where grandma? You better sit your fast hell down somewhere. Like, apparently she doesn't have any of them in her life. And not granted, she actually could have women in her life, but she ain't listening to them. Right? Like, she is pursuing my son like a wild animal pursues its prey. Right? I'm like, son, cut her off. He did like this. He said, yeah. He said, because that kind of like made me feel violated. He's like, he put his hand on his private part. He was like, no, you shouldn't be getting any of this. I'm like, that's right. I said, son, keep yourself strong. Right? I said, don't become one of her victims. Right? Victims of women like that end up in the grave. I said, stay far away from her. Yeah, she's thirsty, Dana. She is thirsty. Right? And so, and I say, you need to be careful too, right? Because I tell him, I was like, boy, when you put on the shirt, like, I was like, you have to be careful about what you're doing too. Like, if you're talking to his cousin Aaron on the phone, Aaron, you know, y'all probably remember Aaron, but he been gone about a year now. He in the military. So, but you know, guys, they talking to each other, they whatever, they walk around shirtless and stuff. You know, I said, but when you're talking to a female on the phone, I said, cover yourself, because they'll be on FaceTime and I'll see that it's a female. I'm like, Jeremiah, come here. I'm like, why is you half naked on the phone talking to that girl? He said, my. I said, but she can't see your shorts. I said, she can see all of this. Go cover it up. Don't give her imagination a reason to wander and want to chase you, right? So I have no doubt that it was a little bit of that in some of the earlier days that she saw the top part of what he working with, right? You know, he's a very handsome gentleman. I said, cover yourself just like women need to cover their breasts, right? Women don't need to see this, right? Because it takes their mind to a place if they're not disciplined, but you don't want to help them go into sin, right? Because when they see something that they want and they thirsty, they gonna come try and get a drink. They gonna try to drink they fill of this cup. I said, so cover it up, put the lid on it, don't let them see it. I said, reserve this for yourself and the woman whom you will pour this drink out to. Fill her only with your love. Don't. Look. I be talking to my son like that. So he's like, yeah, look, yeah, he got to separate from her treatment. She's dangerous. And her, look, and her boyfriend ain't the only one she trying out. I'm telling you, look, so when I shared, I said, you talk to your daddy about this? He said, not yet. He said, like, this literally just happened, and you were here in the house, right? He said, because I know you got a level head. He said, Mom, he said, I don't see too many women like you in the world. He said, because she is not that. He said, I thought she was cool, was friend. He said, and I feel some type of way that she just said this to me. You know, I said, I feel some type of way, she said, because I thought she was a good little girl, apparently. I said, but I don't spend that much time whacking. Hear how she talk or whatever, but she's always the polite or whatever when he's on FaceTime. Hey, Miss Murphy, how you doing? Hey, you know, and I call her by her name or whatever. You know, he'll be talking to her while he's down here cooking him something to eat, and like, she's always on the phone. I was shocked that it was her. I, like I said, I thought it was another girl, but when he told me who it was, I'm like, it was who? Yo, he need to call her out. I don't know. He, at this point, he probably needs to just completely step away. I told him, I said, you need to completely shut that down. I said, stop spending all that time on that phone with her. I said, you told me some things about her little boyfriend. I was like, yeah, that ain't, I say, she crazy. Especially if she, if everybody know that's her boyfriend and he tend to, and you tell me he got a temper, why is she even trying this? I said, sis is putting herself in a dangerous situation. Either she gonna need to, one, separate from that boy, and go out there holding to be in the thigh in the street. Let her flee youthful lust, Dana. Let her separate from this dude that got a bad temper, because he might choke her up once or twice if he ain't already done it, if he find out what she doing. You know, I said, but stay away from women like that, son. Stay away. It don't matter that they're giving you free booty when you want it. Stay away from them. I said, jocks should stay away from women that crowd around them, that cheer squad and them fans that's always on their tips. Stay away from them. Stay away from them. Those are not the ones you want to commit to, right? Don't even give them any of what you got to drink at all. They should get none of it, right? Because you don't want to mess around and do that, and then somebody get attached to you for 18 years. Oh, then it's going to be hell to pay to the captain, right? And you're going to be paying her. I said, so don't do it, son. I said, you need to separate from her. however you do it. I said, you don't have to be nasty and you don't have to be rude. I said, but just less than a time. When she called, just, you know, hey, I'm, you need to be straightforward with her, but, you know, don't be jumping at her calls and stuff. Like, you're going to have to probably kind of phase her away if you're not able to go cold turkey and just stop talking to her altogether. I personally recommend go cold turkey, but sometimes that do seem kind of harsh. But when your life is at stake, I'm out. Right, cutting everything off, blocking him and everything, right? Okay, so that was a little story that I wanted to share with y'all about this verse up here. That was in a previous chapter. Verse, what was it? 27 and 28. Proverbs chapter 24. Hold on. Oh, I didn't go back, did I? Hold on. What did we just read? It's 23. Hold on. I'm going to read it again, that first. Proverbs 23. Verse 27 and 28, it said, and I ain't calling her a prostitute, but I'm just saying she's showing prostitute tendencies. And all prostitutes don't get paid to her boyfriend. I bet she'll stop calling. I don't know. She might just get a little sneaky at Dana because she don't live with her boyfriend, so he don't know what she's doing. With all her time. It says, a prostitute is a dangerous trap. A promiscuous woman is as dangerous as falling into a narrow well. She hides and waits like a robber, eager to make more men unfaithful. Yeah, so I thought about that when I read this. But, all right, y'all. That was our chapters and Proverbs for the day. That was 22, 23, and 24. You said, she'll take him there. That Mavis Staples song. I'll take you there. Yeah, she sure will. Right to the grave. But not on my watch. Not my son. Leave my boys alone. Right? You know, so I can't live their life for them. All I can do is give them wisdom. Right? I give them level-headed wisdom. I give them level-headed wisdom. As will his dad. Sometimes his dad just go in at their head or whoever. Right? I'll give you wisdom to come out of the situation, just, you know, so nobody's hurt intentionally, right? If harming someone can be avoided, we want to do it at all costs, but still, you know, by saving yourself as well. Okay, y'all, I'm your husband, go for the neck. And sometimes that's needed, Damon, sometimes it's needed, go straight for the neck, right? Cut the jugular vein, right? And sometimes that's needed. You know, sometimes it's actually needed. I don't think that's needed just yet. Now, if he come back and tell me, man, this girl just won't give up, then we might have a problem. You're right. These streets ain't loyal. These girls ain't loyal. I know I don't say girls. This is say hoes, but and at this point, he should know. I don't know that he know about his girl. But sis ain't sweet as she pretend to be. I ain't gonna call her out. That's why I said I ain't calling no names. I ain't trying to get nobody killed. But I'm gonna let you know, stay away from my boys. Stay away from them. Stay away from them. You don't want no smoke with me. Okay. Page 57. Oh, it was, yeah, it's a blank page. We stopped at 55. But 56 is blank, so 57. Chapter 10, Jesus in Wonderland. Argument about the existence of a first century Nazareth overshadows closer consideration of other hot spots on the Jesus itinerary. But in fact, the curious obscurity, not to say complete fabrication, of all the other Jesus venues apart from Jerusalem is damning evidence for a historical Jesus in itself. After all, Jesus could have performed his miracles in a major city, say Alexandria or even Rome. By impressing the movers and shakers of the age, he could have saved humanity with far less palaver. But his chosen arena was a provincial backwater. He was born, we are told, into the territory ruled by Herod the Great, although the king actually died in 4 BC. In the year 6 of the first century, the heartland of Herod's former kingdom became the Roman province of Judea. But the patch of land where Jesus supposedly performed most of his mighty deeds and uttered his enigmatic parables was the district of Galilee, an area actually smaller than metropolitan Los Angeles, sandwiched between Judea to the south and Roman Syria to the north. At the time of Jesus's mission, that fiefdom was ruled by Herod's son, Antipas. As a client of Rome, like his father, Antipas accelerated the Romanization of the region, most visibly with new or redeveloped towns. Foremost among them was Sepphoris, a city just 4 miles north of where Nazareth now stands, and Tiberias, the new capital of Galilee, and so named in tribute to the master of the Roman world, the Emperor Tiberius. Yet oddly, these two largest cities of Galilee go unmentioned in the gospel narrative. The omission of Tiberias from the gospel story is particularly enigmatic. The city was actually sited on the shore of the modest-sized lake, which the author of Mark restyled the Sea of Galilee, and about which his hero Jesus continuously meanders. Before Mark got to work, that body of water was known as the Gennesaret to the Jews, Lake Gennesar to the Greeks, and Lake Taricia to the Romans. The fact that Mark gave a new name to the lake and called it a sea is a clue to Mark's method and purpose. He was not reporting the history of real events. He was writing an allegory of suffering and salvation set within a landscape that resembled but was not reality. By the shores of the so-called Sea of Galilee in the first century AD stood 3 other important lakeside towns, Taricia, Julius, and Hippos. All were within a few hours walking distance of each other, but yet again, Jesus somehow manages to avoid entering any one of them. Even when taking ship across the lake, which he often does, Jesus never lands at the harbors of Tiberias, Taricia, etc., but at places named Dalmanutha, the coast of Magadan, etc., places which neither ancient authority nor modern archaeology can confirm ever existed. Bizarrely, the gospel Jesus manages to circumvent all the towns that are on his doorstep. Wait a minute. I look like it's missing a word. Maybe it should say in the gospel. Bizarrely, in the gospel, Jesus manages to circumvent all the towns that are on his doorstep, and before the grand finale in Jerusalem, avoids any city where there might have been an educated resident able to record his mighty deeds. During the ministry of Jesus, nearly all the action occurs within a tiny strip of ground, scarcely 4 miles wide, on the lake's northern shore. At its center is the city of Capernaum, in reality, a one donkey village about the size of a parking lot, which becomes Jesus's hometown. The best confirmation we have that even a village existed in Jesus's day is referenced by Josephus in his autobiography, which is found in Life on page 72. To falling from his horse and being carried to a village called Sepharnicus. Christian scholars have gleefully equated this village with the Capernaum of the Gospels. At or within a few miles walk of Capernaum, Jesus calls his disciples, preaches the Sermon on the Mount, feeds the 5,000, walks on water, performs assorted healings, expels many demons, and so on. Yet for all those displays of divine power, the city with its two neighboring villages, of Chorazin and Bethsaida weren't convinced by his claims and were cursed by the world's savior for their unbelief. And that's found in Matthew chapter 11, verse 23. Even supposing that God's plan could be so quixotic as to confine his son's activity to such a restricted and unappreciative space of real estate, the difficulties of Jesus, the difficulties of the Jesus trail go much deeper. When he moves away from the lake, where does Jesus go? Not to any places confirmed by other sources. For example, we know from Josephus, the commander of the Jewish forces in Galilee during the war with Rome, that he fortified 19 towns and villages, and he names them. Foremost among them was Joppa, where Josephus himself was captured by the Romans. From Joppa, Josephus would have been able to see Nazareth if it had existed. But instead, Josephus tells us of Joppa, which he describes as the largest village in all of Galilee. Joppa just happens to share the same location as today's Nazareth. But neither Joppa, Jotapatha, nor Jaffa, nor any of those 19 Galilean towns and villages are mentioned in the gospel story. Did Jesus actually visit certain pagan cities that we know from extant ruins certainly did exist? Sidon, Tyre, Caesarea, Philippi, and Gadara? That isn't quite what the gospels say. They came to the country of the Gadarenes, Mark 5 and verse 4. He arose and went to the region of Tyre and Sidon, Mark chapter 7 and 24. He returned through the midst of the coast of Decapolis, Mark 7 chapter 24. Jesus came to the coast of Caesarea Philippi, Matthew 16 verse 13. How vague. Was the man Jesus so fearful of contamination by the sinful urbanites that he loitered in the outskirts and crept from one tiny hamlet to another? Or is the truth more mundane, that he is a fictional character moved around a fictionalized landscape? In any event, the most developed and lucrative parts of this world religion, In any event, the most developed and lucrative parts of this whole region were not the Jewish enclaves of Judea and Galilee at all, but an area originally settled by the Greeks, the Decapolis, Federation of Ten Cities. Here were cities that straddled the trade route that ran from Damascus to Caesarea, the provincial capital that grew to five times the size of Jerusalem, though never visited by Jesus. The city of Decapolis, Scythopolis, Gerasa, Capitolius, and Pella among them, prospered for centuries and have left us many fascinating ruins, eloquent testimony. I do not, son. Ask your dad. He should have a stash. If not, just stop by the gas station.
I saw my check. I got some happy. I was like, yeah. Savings. Because when I went to the mall, it went straight down. And I put it back and it went back. So I was like, okay. I didn't know if you want check, but hey, okay, I'm happy. That actually got me hanging. I was like,
look, where's your belt, son?
I have joggers on, and just to make
some. Are you gonna take that jacket off while you want to drop tonight?
Probably.
I'm gonna need you to find a belt.
And you know, I also got my blue shirt. Well,
get it on. Don't be out of uniform. Oh, and y'all may not need to stop. When you get to the warehouse, if you look up in the cabinet in the kitchen, it's a whole big bag of like those Lifesaver candies. You can just grab some out of there. All right. Gotta stay on top of them. Pull yourself together, son. You represent the whole family. Okay, look. The Gospels of Mark. No, let me read the city. This census again. The cities of Decapolis, Scythopolis, Gerasa, Capitolis, and Pella among them prospered for centuries and have left us many fascinating ruins, eloquent testimony to their former greatness. The Gospels of Mark and Matthew name the Decapolis, but you would never guess from the casual mention of the name the importance of the region. And again, Jesus never trod any of its cities. Did the Son of God come to earth with a message of cosmic importance, intent not only not to write down one word of that message, but also determined during his entire ministry to avoid every single town of any significance that might have, as they say, given witness to his passing? Where was Jesus baptized? Today, thousands of tourists visit the attractive baptism site of Yardenet, just south of the Sea of Galilee. But Yardenet is completely fake, created by the Israeli Ministry of Tourism in 1981, when the traditional site had been long closed by war and minefields. So where was the traditional site? Only the Gospel of John gives a location, Bethany beyond the Jordan. Yet even in the second century, Christians could not find such a place. Church Father Origen decided that what John really meant was Bethabara. And where was Bethabara? It just happened to be the place that Jews had already sanctified as the place where the Israelites had entered the Promised Land. But by the 6th century, as witnessed by the extant Madaba mosaic in a Jordanian church, Byzantine Christians had sighted Bethabara on the western side of the river, not beyond the Jordan at all. The Gospel of John mentions a second baptism site, Enon, near Salim. Where was that? The church fathers decided that it was south of Scythopolis, today's Beth Shean. My bad. Okay. At a place called Salumius. But by the 4th century, at a time when Christianity had become the official religion of the empire, Enon, near Salim, was placed opposite Bethabara at the place where the faithful had once looked for Bethany. And why did they choose this place? Because this is where the Jews claim that Elijah had ascended to heaven. And John the Baptist, of course, was the new Elijah. When biblical archaeology arrived on the scene in the 19th century, determined Christians had yet other ideas. Salim was now equated with Shechem, today's Nablus, and the enthusiasts of Christ looked for an Anon, a word meaning spring, in the Shechem area. And there they found a village called Salim and decided that this must be the site of Salim. That's actually spelled different. The first Salim. There they found a village called, I'm sorry, Salem. I'm saying Salim. S-A-L-E-M. And decided that this must be the site of Salim. S-A-L-I-M. As a result, Anons near Salim's are all over the place, and they are all bogus. One problem with placing the baptism site near Shechem is that it is in the middle of Samaria. Not so smart for a Jewish holy man, and nowhere close to the wilderness of Judea. Where did Jesus meet the Samaritan woman at the well? The Gospel of John says Sychar. But this town was also unknown either before or after the time of Jesus. Early Christians decided that Sychar must be Shechem, where the Jews had determined that Joseph had his tomb and Jacob his plot of land. So here it was that they located a previously unknown Jacob's well, where Jesus could utter his words about living water. Where was the gated town of Nain, where Jesus raised a widow's son from the dead? Luke chapter 7, verse 11. The honor has long been given to a village of a similar name, Nain, N-E-I-N, first settled by Muslims. But Josephus reports that Nain, N-A-I-N, was far to the south on the borders of Idumea and confirms that it did have a, that it had a wall. And that's found in Wars of the Jews, chapter 4, verse 9. Where was Cana? That place where Jesus supposedly converted water into wine at a wedding feast, John chapter 2, verse 1. At least four places have been argued for from one side of Galilee to the other. Cana, Kerbet Cana, and Kepher Cana, and Ain Cana. All of those have different spellings, but all of those, Cain's, Kerbet, Cana, Canaan, Kepher, Cana, they all start with K's. Not one of them with convincing evidence. Josephus even refers to Kanatha, which starts with a C, a city of Decapolis, as Cana, which starts with a C, which is a place of Caesarea, which starts with a C. And you can find that in Josephus's Antiquities, chapter 15, verse 5. Siri.
One moment.
I didn't ask you anything. Siri. Close. Where was Emmaus, where Jesus appeared to two of his followers after his resurrection? Luke chapter 24, verse 13. Again, at least four places line up for the honor. Nicopolis, Abu Ghosh, Colonia, and El Qubebe. Qubebe. It's just spelled different. Q-U-B-E-I-B-E-H. But not one of them quite fits the gospel story. On the one hand, we have evidence, both from written sources and archaeology, of a great many villages, towns, and cities, which oddly have no place in the gospel story supposedly acted out all around them. On the other hand, we have a string of gospel events in which the miraculous routinely, happens only in utterly obscure places, none of them known to Josephus or any other historian of the time, and which are unidentifiable today. The conclusion is inescapable. History and the gospel story exist in different, History and the gospel story exist in different universes. Jesus' land is a fictional landscape, a literary creation of an imaginary world for a Jesus who never existed. Trina, I just saw your comment. You said, Pam, they listening. Okay, y'all. Chapter 11. The New Apologist. Let's see. Oh, okay. So it's a part two. I didn't realize this was broken up into two sections. Okay. So this chapter 11 is the last chapter of part one. And then it breaks it up and says part two, an interview with Kenneth Humphreys. Okay. So the rest of this. Okay, so it's 9BB and KH. There are questions and then there's answers. Okay. Where we at? 5840? It's Saturday. I'll ask y'all if y'all want me to read some of it. Okay. The New Apologist. The idea that Jesus never existed, a thesis simply ignored in the 20th century by the vested interests of religion and biblical scholarship, has argued its way back onto the agenda. It has compelled the mandarins of orthodoxy to issue angry rebuttals and insistent mantra, but of course Jesus existed. Yet whisper-thin defenses of a historical Jesus do not cut it in the internet-enabled world, and established academics don't like that one bit. Jen, shalom. I saw somebody else come in. Hardhead. I saw you come in a while ago. I meant to say something. I was in the middle of the story, my son. I forgot to say, hey. Many are incandescent that peons now have a voice, and that voice is being heard. I'll read that again. Let me just go back and read this. Look. The idea that Jesus never existed, a thesis simply ignored in the 20th century by the vested interests of religion and biblical scholarship, has argued its way back onto the agenda. It has compelled the mandarins of orthodoxy to issue angry rebuttals and insistent mantra, but of course Jesus existed. Yet whisper-thin defenses of a historical Jesus do not cut it in the internet-enabled world, and established academics don't like that one bit. Many are incandescent that peons now have a voice, and that voice is being heard. The online arena can be rude and crude, but as with the printing press 600 years ago, the power of a cartel has been broken, and for some taste, the wrong kind of people have gained an audience. Increasing numbers of web-savvy inquirers are asking, what real evidence is there for a historical Jesus? And they are not convinced by the replies. With the supernatural elements removed from the gospel story, what then is left of a man called Jesus to remember decades after his death? Why would he be remembered at all when numerous other Jesuses were forgotten? The proponents of a historical Jesus defend the idea that a single man became the focus about which a stupendous legend grew. Yet does a mountain of artifice really need a dead non-entity to get going? The scholarly establishment has failed to win the skeptical public over with their weak arguments and arrogant dismissal of the case for a mythical Jesus. Is it really so difficult to grasp that Hellenized Jews finally cast adrift from a devastated temple Judaism, should concoct precisely that syncretism of man and God, which merged Jewish notions of historical determinism and its anticipated Messiah with the mores of polytheism? I'm frozen on Facebook. Y'all had to hop on over here to YouTube. They might not even hear me say that. In the 21st century, the non-existence of Jesus has passed from the obsession of a lunatic fringe that could be contemptuously ignored to a global battle for truth, characterized as much by its churlish language and speed of development as by argument and counter-argument. Okay, that might just be yours, Shayla. Tiffany said hers not frozen. Okay, I'm going to keep going. The result is that a paradigm shift is in progress. So what has really happened in recent decades? For the whole of the 20th century, historicists controlled the universities and main publishing houses, yet they failed to discover any new evidence for Jesus in the Levant. Instead, we saw two important developments. The first was the ascendancy of the Christian right in the United States and a concomitant domination of New Testament studies by well-funded fundamentalism. What, babe?
You tell Zay turn upstairs in our room.
Turn the crap stuff off our TV. The effect of this was to poison the well from which even secular scholars still draw. These historicists, heirs to the tradition that had rejected the divinity of Jesus, have become, by force of circumstances, pawns of the religious establishment. They are the new apologists, recycling the sophistry of fundamentalist arguments shorn of the supernatural elements. These scholars were and are stubborn defenders of their own fundamentalist belief in Jesus as a historical figure. In fact, many of them cling. What? Okay, my, what you call it, just went off. I'm going to keep going because my light's still on and it's still rolling. Let me see. In fact, many of them cling to a sentimental affection for the church they once knew and a Jesus they once loved. A second game-changing development has been the rapid development of technology of communication. With the ubiquitousness of the internet and the rise of self-publishing, we have entered a new era. Once again, the control over information by a cartel has been broken. Jesus deniers are able to sidestep the arcane apparatus of traditional biblical scholarship and for the first time in history, directly reach a global audience. The mythicists have a voice in books and ebooks and conferences and video, films, lectures, and are being heard in ever larger numbers. Thanks to the internet, the many alternative strands of mythicism have given rise to a tsunami of commentaries that is irrigating the dry landscape. In this new globalized debate, the voice of the traditional expert is but one muffled refrain. Old school academics are appalled and angered by this threat to their calm and leisured study of religion, to their loss of a monopoly long exercised through the great university libraries, PhD degrees, and expensive professional journals. Hurriedly and in vain, they have attempted to dismiss the entire scholarship of mythicism with magisterial pronouncements, know-it-all pomposity, and visceral attacks on Jesus skeptics as clowns and idiots. Belatedly, as their prestige and preeminence disappears, they are forced to acknowledge the new landscape. Arrogance and pomposity wins new friends. The nagging questions remain. Why was Jesus notable if he did not draw multitudes from across the region? Why was he remembered decades later if he did not perform spectacular healing and miracles? Why is it that all non-gospel sources that underpin the historical Jesus or are hypothetical sources, oral, tradition, Aramaic sources, QML, etc.? Why is the core historical episode of the gospel tradition, the story of Jesus' death on the cross, completely lacking in convincing historical detail, being rather a liturgical drama built up from the Psalms and prophetic texts? That's a quotation from the Jesus myth denier, Joseph Hoffman, in his more skeptical days. Why did the followers of Jesus just start believing that he had been resurrected if the laws of the universe had not been suspended? Who precisely were the authors of the canonical gospels? Is it not very curious indeed that these supposed truthful compilers of history were unknown in time or place, even in the second century? For that matter, where is the compelling evidence the early Christian writers were referring to the same minor individual? If a real Jesus influenced the story in any way at all, how can we be so certain that only one such figure had that sort of nebulous and very tangible influence? Did it require a human component to fabricate the high priest Melchizedek, the archangel Michael, the son of man Enoch, the tribal autocrat Moses, the conquering hero Joshua, the miracle-working prophet Elijah? With such a cornucopia of templates to work from, what precisely did the myth makers require from a mere dead man before they could get to work? The new apologetics is at its weakest at precisely those points where the old apologetics offers miracle and marvel to resolve difficulties. Bar Ehrman, a dangerous radical by traditional standards, by avoiding the logical conclusion to be drawn from his own work, risked becoming the Martin Luther of this internet-enabled reformation. Ehrman admits that for 30 years, he has to think about the hymn in the Philippines, an early pre-Pauline source, which just happens to describe Christ Jesus as a dying, rising God. The original Luther was a good Catholic who, like Ehrman, wanted to get back to the original text. But Luther also started something he couldn't stop. The printing press did the rest. Given the exponential growth of the internet, in but a few years, the mythicist notion of the non-existence of Jesus, that it is all a fiction, will become the accepted and obvious truth. Y'all, I think it completely disconnected me all together. All right, so we're going to end here. We're at an hour and 10 minutes, and this, my connection keeps saying it's unstable. So we're going to go ahead and end it. So I hope y'all enjoyed the reading for today, beautiful people. Mark my page. So we're not going to read anymore. I'm going to call Verizon and have them come out here and text it and test my Wi-Fi connection. They probably won't get out here today. So I'm going to see how to do this. I wonder though, if I could run a cord from my whatchacallit so that doesn't happen. I'm gonna have to look into some stuff. But let me go ahead and end this, y'all, because this connection about to pluck my nerve for this live. I need to figure something out. All right, so today it is Saturday, beautiful people, December 11th, 2021, day 325 of year 3 of reading through the books of the Law and the Prophets, and of the 3-year consecutive day count, day 993. We read Proverbs 22, 23, and 24, and we read Jesus Never Existed, page 55 through 73. I'm gonna go ahead and do the blessing. Bella and ran upstairs. I'm gonna just have to deal with her today. Let me move this over. Let me get this fixed, y'all. I'm sorry. Now, I still see 2 people here. Maybe it came back in. I don't know. But it still says the chat is unable. Okay, Trina, yes. Call me a little bit whenever you're free. I'm ready, sis. I'm ready. I need to hear this. Look. Okay. Hold on. Let me pull this up. And as we start, look, y'all, I'm so excited about, I know YouTube probably can't hear me. I'm so excited about us growing here, right? As we take it up a notch. Okay. The blessing is found in Numbers chapter 6, verses 22 through 27. And Yahuwah spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto Aaron and unto his son, saying, on this wise, ye shall bless the children of Israel, saying unto them, Yahuwah will kneel before us presenting gifts, and will guard us with a hedge of protection. Yahuwah will illuminate the wholeness of his being towards us, bringing order, and he will provide us with love, sustenance, and friendship. Yahuwah will lift up his wholeness of being and look upon us, and he will set in place all we need to be whole and complete. All right, beautiful people. I love y'all, and I see y'all won't be here tomorrow, right? We're going to rest tomorrow. Remember the new moon showed last Sunday, so tomorrow would be the first Sabbath of this moon cycle. If you're observing the cycle, the Sabbath days according to the clock in the sky, right? Some people still celebrating it today, some celebrated yesterday. Either way, y'all, we all learning and growing together, right? Okay. All right, y'all. So I see y'all Monday morning at 7:15 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Peace.